Alright, Test, Test. Hallo? Test? Does it work? Okay. This doesn't work out. Alright. Welcome to my talk about the security workflow we in the Type 3 security team are following. My name is Helmut. I'm part of the Type 3 community for quite some long time. I'm a core developer and also member of the Type 3 security team. So what is the idea of this talk? The security team itself is very much working behind the scenes. So the visible outcome of what we do is not like in the core team where you see, okay, this member just pushed a patch and this one is merged and there are discussions publicly around several issues and stuff like that. The work of the security team is more or less hidden, and I will talk about that, why this is the case. And with this talk, I want to elaborate a little bit of how the work that we are doing is actually structured and what certain steps in what workflow we are following. So basically, going back to agenda, this is how the talk is also mentioned, and basically this is our workflow in a flat view. So somehow security issue is discovered, then we're going to fix it and we have to test it, and then of course we have to release it and make an announcement, which is, by the way, the only visible outcome of the work of the security team. So looking into detail, how are security issues actually discovered? So how is this, how can I test an application and find security bugs with it? Basically, it all boils down to one single thing, and this is playing with input parameters. So you have an application, you can type anything in, and you're playing around with the input. And this very much is, or can be called as, some kind of creative process. So you have to know a little bit of about possible security issues, and even if you know that, you still have to try out, play a little bit, try this input, try the other input. And this is one of my favorite, all-time favorite slides or comics from XKCD. So in this case, mom played a little bit with input, which is the name of her child, and tested the application of the university. You can do other stuff like this one. I don't know if anybody has seen this car before. So this is also some kind of user input, which is placed on the license plate of the car. And this is a penetration test of the car license plate observing cameras and applications. So just to give you a small small sense of the feeling, how it can be a creative process without going into too much details. So how are security issues actually found? Of course, you're playing with input, but how do you play with input? And there are several ways to do so. There's one way, which is really manually creating license plates or naming your child in a special way, or filling form fields with special characters that might lead to some kind of unexpected behavior of the application. But there are also things like penetration tools, which are often used by security researchers to test an application in a security audit automatically. So you just set some kind of parameters in this penetration tool, and then this penetration tool just throws some patterns of basically input parameters to the application and checks the outcome. So for example, it tries to add some HTML code to some input fields of a form and then checks if this HTML code is actually encoded after transmission of the form or if it's plain used in the result of after submission of the form. And there are, of course, exploitation tools, which are pretty much like penetration testing tools, but the intention is a little bit different. For penetration testing tools, this is, of course, done in security audits by security specialists. Exploitation tools have a different focus. They just want to attack and exploit known vulnerabilities of applications. And they are made for mass attacking applications. For example, I don't know if you heard about that. Lately, there was some brute force attacking of Type3 backend logins. So this is one kind of mass attack tool, but there are different other tools that can be used that not only find security vulnerabilities, but at the same time also inject some malicious code to websites. So this is roughly the first part. So how is a security issue discovered? And if someone discovers an issue in Type3, we usually get a report. And what kind of people are reporting to us? Of course, there are security researchers which have done some penetration testing, for example, for a customer project, and they send us the outcome of this penetration test and report this to us, or server admins or Type3 admins, which just see some suspicious log files in their access logs and then contact us and ask us for help. And sometimes there are also Type3 users which discover some weird content on their website, and they're also contacting us and asking us if their site maybe has been hacked or not. And probably you also contacted me or us and asked for help, and you're encouraged to do so. And there's only one single point for contacting us, and this is this email address. So if you're thinking, if you're thinking that you have found a security issue, or you're not sure if you found a security issue and like to ask a question to us, just use this email, and this will be distributed in our mailing list and in our ticketing system, and we'll follow the process then, which I will describe shortly. And we are getting a lot of good reports. Good reports somehow look like this. They have a descriptive subject, and they have a detailed description what is actually happening with some kind of user input. And at best, they also provide a proof of concept, where you can see in this example the issue we fixed lately in the file abstraction layer, that you could have created arbitrary files in the file system. And we also get some kind of bad reports, which more or less, or sometimes look like this. This is actually copying pasting from one report we got. It doesn't mention anything except that, or not anything useful for us, except that the sender of this report wants to be in the Hall of Fame. And that boils down to the fact that what I already mentioned, a good report. So if you want to contact us, it would be good if you have a detailed description or a detailed question. You also mention the affected version or the version you have tested the issue to occur in. And of course, a proof of concept or, for example, steps to reproduce the issue. Basically, how a good bug report also would look like. Speaking of bad reports, nevertheless, we are thankful for every report. So we are taking every report seriously, even if it at first sight looks a little bit weird or not enough information. We try to contact back the author, the reporters, and ask them for further details. So don't hesitate to contact us if you, if you have a question or think you have found something. Of course. After we get, after someone contacts us, we respond, and we respond to every request we get. We try to make it as soon as possible. We have a goal set up once that our response time should be lower than 48 hours. 48 hours for working days, so if you contact us on the weekend, it might be extended a little bit. Sometimes it doesn't work out, so if you're sending us and don't get feedback for a week or so, just feel free to send us a friendly reminder. But if we send you a response, then in this response, we ask you or we ask the reporters to not disclose anything of this information to the public. So why do we do so? Because we follow a so-called responsible disclosure policy. This means that the whole process, like I already mentioned before, is handled privately. So everything, every communication, every fixing, everything is done privately, and this is done because we want to protect Type 3 users before the issue itself is known widely. So we want to give the Type 3 users a little bit more time before hackers potential attackers could know about the issue to protect themselves. So this is why we do this this whole process in private, and publish the issue itself always together with a fix or a possible solution. So how does the workflow look like until now? So of course we get a report to this email address. And then we are checking if the report is valid. If it's not valid, we reply anyway. Oops, uh-oh. I forgot to plug in my laptop. Where is my charger? Sorry. And sometimes it happens that we think the issue isn't valid and respond. But it sometimes also happens that the reporter just, do I have, all right. Okay, back on track. That the reporters then contact us again and say, oh, okay, but don't you think this can still be an issue? So, and of course, if it's if the issue is valid, then we also reply and ask for treating this confidentially. And looking at this process until now, there are probably you have two questions in mind. And one is, what is a valid issue anyway? And the other is, what are security issues? So what is a security issue? So like I said before, security issues are nothing more than bugs. But not every bug itself is a security issue. So how can I know then if a bug in an application affects security? A helpful rule of thumb is looking at the CIA triad, and this has nothing to do with the Central Intelligence Agency, but it's things that should be there that some kind of information is secure. So one part of that is that the information or the confidentiality of information should be kept, so that information that is only meant to be accessible from a certain part of group, then it should only be accessible for this group and not for anything everybody else. The integrity of the information must be kept, so it must not be possible to somehow change the information. And the last thing is, information should be available. So if you have a bug, for example, that affects the availability, so for example, if you specify, I don't know, some kind of input parameter, and after that the application crashes completely and is not available anymore, then you can say, okay, it's a bug, and it's also a security issue because it affects availability. Depending on your needs and your special project on your website, some of these three things might be prioritized. So it might be that availability is not so important, but integrity is very important, or vice versa. So it's not so important that the information is correct, but at least that some information is always available. So basically, yeah, security issues are bugs. And if anything of these three are affected, then you can be pretty sure that this is a security issue which should be handled by us. But still, even if one of these three things are affected, it does not mean automatically that we are going to handle it in our secret private workflow, because to save us some work, we set up three easy rules, which the first one, which means is that we are not going to handle security issues, for example, in a development branch in private. So if you have, for example, an SQL injection introduced only in a development branch, then we will of course fix it, and we will also tag it in the commit message with a security or as a security fix, but we just do it in public. And this also is true for not supported branches. So for example, we won't fix any security issues in 4.0 because we don't fix any bugs in there anyway, because we said the maintenance time for these old versions is just over. There might be some exceptions in case of very severe security issues, but in general, we are, yeah, just won't fix issues there. We, of course, also handle issues which are exploitable even if you're not authenticated, and we are handling issues which are exploitable as editors. So you need to have a login, for example, like the issue with the file abstraction layer I showed you before. This was only exploitable if you had an editor's account. But we are not going to fix any SQL injection problem which is only exploitable by admins, because admins don't need to exploit SQL injections, they just install an extension of their like, and they can do anything anyway. So we are going to fix the SQL injection in that case, of course, because that's always bad to not encode your user input, but we just handle it in public. So how does the fixing look like? So if we are done with the process that we acknowledged, okay, this is a valid security issue we need to handle in our responsible disclosure workflow, we're going to coordinate with a core team, or since lately I have to extend this a little bit and not only core team but involve all active contributors in, yeah, just saying, okay, we have this problem here, we have this bug, it leads to security issues, can someone please take over and fix this? And if someone takes over, this person is going to submit patches to a private repository. And yeah, basically the workflow is then the same like bug fixing. The only difference is that it's a private repository. And then we're going to test it. And this is one issue I would talk a little bit about, because currently we are very focused, or the only opportunity we have in many cases is that we have to do manual tests. And this is a really some kind of big issue, not only that it takes a lot of time to do so, but the other issue is that we are a very small group of people. Not everybody in this group has time to do tests, even if we have someone who fixes the issue, which leads to not very much feedback if the fix itself is okay. And we are currently still lacking functional tests, speaking of type 3 CMS, and we're also lacking integration tests, so that we cannot see if any change we have done, any fix, affects somehow the, for example, the backend experience for editors. So if you would like to help, it's highly appreciated. So if you say you're some kind of functional or integration testing guru, just contact us or contact me directly during the conference. Another idea would be, which is currently not yet discussed, but it's only an idea floating around, is that we are just extending the group of people who are doing tests. So not only active contributors and keeping the group very small to not disclose too much information, because we want to keep it as secret as possible until we have a final fix, but just extend it a little bit to a group of more people who are interested in testing, and letting them install them, for example, on some kind of production, or even on production systems, kind of a pre-release version of type 3 version with a fixed security bug, and getting feedback from them so that we can be sure that we don't introduce severe regressions or regressions at all in a security release, which we unfortunately had in recent times. And of course, you're also invited to contact us if you say, okay, I'm interested in this topic, I would like to help the security team to get all this work done. You're also invited to contact us or me and become a security team member and help us during this workflow. So this is a workflow you know already. Like I said, we are going to create patches, we are going to submit them to the repository, then we're getting reviews. Sometimes we reject reviews because we introduce regressions and we caught these through unit tests or manual tests. And if finally the reviews are done, then it continues. If this issue itself is fixed and we say, okay, the fix is ready, we can release it, then we have to start writing an announcement and, of course, doing a release. For the announcement, it's also important to know that we try to follow some limited disclosure. So we say, okay, we have fixed an issue, but we're not going into details about how to exploit this issue. This is also to protect our users, to give our users a little bit more time so that people probably, or attackers probably don't figure out, okay, there's this issue, but I have to take care to figure out how to exploit this. But I'm not sure if this is really useful, and I would like to hear your feedback after this talk, or even at the conference later, if you should just drop it and give all type of free users all information needed. So for example, referencing the patch file where it is patched, and also presenting a way to exploit it so that users of type 3 or admins of type 3 can decide, am I affected at all by this? Because, okay, if it's exploitable by in this way, for example, you have to be logged in and you have to do this and that, I'm not affected at all, so I can just wait a few days until I have more time to do the update. So probably it would be better to make really, in the announcement, a full disclosure. So it might be changed in the future, but it's also currently discussed. So how does an advisory look like? Who have not seen something like this? Okay, so everybody. I just want to focus on the small things, or show you a small thing, little things you have to focus if you're looking at a bulletin. The first look should go to the affected version, because if the affected version, like in this case, is 6.0 and every single type of free installation you have is 4.5, you just don't have to take any action. The second look should go to the problem description. We try to be as elaborate as possible with the limited disclosure thing we currently follow. So if, just read it carefully, it's not too long, and it should give you, together with a solution, enough information to know, am I affected at all? And do I need to take action immediately, or is it only a problem when a user is logged in and I anyway trust any editor I have in all my Type 3 installations, so yeah, I have more time to fix or update my Type 3 installation. And the last thing is the so-called CVSS score. Who has heard of CVSS and knows what this is? Okay, actually it's kind of cryptic and it's not very, it looks like not very useful information, so I want to show you how you can get informations out of it. So basically it's what we try with the score, it's a standardized scoring system, is to give you a little bit of a feeling how important it is or how fast you should fix your installation or update your installation. And the result of this score is if the number is very high, which is 10, then it's very critical and you should do immediate action. If the number is very low, for example 2, then it's not so critical. And it's composed by, can you see this? Yeah, I think it might be okay. It is composed, or the final number is composed by several parts, and one is the impact matrix. I showed you the CIA triad, it's used here again. So it basically shows what is affected by this security bug. So in this case, the confidentiality is only affected partially, whatever that means, but it's not complete disclosure of everything on your system. And the integrity is also affected a little bit or partially, but the availability, for example, is not affected at all. So if you have, for example, a Type 3 installation where availability is very important and the other things are not so important, then you can say, ah, okay, this might be not so problematic for me. And the part above is also quite interesting because it gives you a hint how this issue can be exploited. So since we have a web application, the first one is always the same. The access vector is always through a network, so it's not direct server access or stuff like that. We don't handle, as Type 3 security team, we don't handle direct server access and hard disk theft. So this is for Type 3 always the same, but what is the second one? The complexity. Yeah, this the complexity setting. Sorry, can be low, medium, or high, and this means how complicated is it to exploit this vulnerability? So sometimes it's very complicated, and you have to jump through a lot of hoops and turn around and click here and click there and do this and that, and many prerequisites have to be met that you can exploit it, then the access complexity would be high, which means if the access complexity is high, that the probability that you're going to be attacked by anyone is relatively low. And the other one is also pretty important. Basically, for Type 3, we have two values we select here, and this is the authentication. If none is mentioned here, this means that no user has to be authenticated at all. So it does not have to be a front-end user logged in or a back-end user logged in. Just the website being available is enough to exploit this vulnerability. So if this is none, you should be a little bit faster in updating, because and especially if the complexity is low. If you have, if we set this to, I think single instance is the other one, this means that you have to be logged in as backend user, basically. And if you only have type 3 installations where you have a limited set of editors and you can say, okay, I trust everybody who is editor in this installation, then this also gives you some time to plan for the update. And yeah, out of these values we set there, there's a result in the base score in the above left, and there's also then the temporal metrics where we basically mention or try to give you a hint if this is an issue which is has only been, at least at our knowledge, known to us, or if it's already being exploited by people. So if we have set the remediation level to, the exploitation level to widespread. In this case, it's only functional exploit exists, which means, yeah, we know we have an exploit possibility, but it's only known to us. But if we set this to widespread, this means that we know there is a possibility to exploit this, and we have been contacted by at least one person who said, okay, my server has been attacked by using this exploit. And this gives you a final temporal score. So if, it might be the case that it's lower than the base score, because we have an official fix, and which is, in case for type 3, always the case. And if it's widespread, then it might be a little bit higher, but basically it's lower, because we always have it officially fixed. And if you like, I don't have highlighting for that. If you like, you could also set some values for your environments. So for example, you can say, like I mentioned before in the example, the availability is very important to me, and you can set this to a very high value, then you can get the final environmental score, which can be a lot higher, because availability is affected. So that's basically this one. Giving you an idea, I showed basically the workflow, how we're going through. And the last one is writing the advisory, or close to the last one is writing the advisory. What do you think? How long does it take to write such an advisory? So who thinks that this takes up or not more than 30 minutes? Okay, no one. 1 hour? 2 hours? Who thinks 2 hours? Okay, yeah, that would be nice if it would only take 2 hours. So this is close to an average. So mostly it takes more than 4 hours to do so, to collect all informations, to mention the report or copy-pasting in there, proofreading it, improving the wording of what we say if it's not clear. And doing so in a type 3 installation using TTNews, basically. So this is a TTNews message, and having close to no help. So this is just the body text field and all the available, all the dates and the CVSS are all done manually. So what we are planning is to have an incident handling system so that we can have structured input, so that we just enter, for example, or just select, not enter manually, but select versions affected, and also a structured output, which would benefit you, for example, because we're planning to have RSS output, or probably also an API, which you can use in some kind of infrastructure environment, for example, Nagios or Caretaker or whatever, that these things are evaluated. And of course, it would be less error prone and hopefully would save us some valuable time. And any help on that project is highly appreciated. It's planned since very long. We have a rough concept for it. It's now revived. At least I have put it again on my agenda, on my personal agenda. And if you're interested in writing a very nice and cool Flow application, which has some really nice, not too complicated, but also not too easy business logic, you're welcome as a developer to help us doing so. Just contact us or speak to me. And if you say, okay, I'm not a developer, of course, sponsoring is also welcome. So what is the final workflow? You have seen this already. If reviews are fine, then we're going to write the announcement, cherry pick from the private repository to the upstream repository, package all the things on our packaging server, compose a download page, and finally publish the announcement. So, last estimate, how do you think does this whole process take? So who thinks this takes 2 days? Who thinks this takes more than 2 days? Okay. So this is kind of a confession. The first one I'm pretty proud of. So there were very severe security issues where we got a report, and 36 hours later we got everything done because it was really, really highly critical. We have unfortunately some things which are in our queue for long, like the FEL stuff, which took basically several months. And this is really bad. And we like to improve in that case, and we're working on that. And one idea also, it's just an idea I want to probably discuss with you, is to, if we're seeing we don't have any manpower to fix things in time, that we're going to escalate it to make it more and more public. So because protecting the users is only then useful, and handling this in private, if it's done in a reasonable time frame. Because the longer the time goes, the more likely it is that potential attackers will know it anyway. So the idea is to just escalate it after four weeks. If we say, okay, we didn't manage to handle this security issue after 4 weeks, that we are probably not going to make it public, but broader the group, like the testing group or stuff like that. And if we don't going to manage it within 8 weeks or stuff like that, then we're just going to make it public and inform the users, okay, we have this problem, we are not being able to fix, please help us. And then the users at least know if they are affected or not affected, and they can deal with it and probably do some mitigations themselves, for example, kick out some editors which are potentially not trustable or stuff like that. So that's basically it. Time is over, I guess. I don't know if we have a minute or two for questions or... Oh, okay. So, all right, great. So, do we have a mic for...
So you often combine a lot of security announcements for different extensions in one announcement. So how many days or weeks do you collect these announcements, and how does it depend? This period depends on the severity of the incidents.
That's a good question. I focused my talk on core security issues and not extension security issues. For extension security issues, we have basically two kind of processes. One is the so-called collective security bulletins. This is where we say we allow authors to fix the issue and upload a fixed version. So if you're having some kind of caretaker or stuff like that, you probably see Yeah, probably not. If you're following the releases of the extensions, then you probably notice that there's a security issue fixed, but we collect them over some period of time, which, yeah, it's not really set. It's kind of, okay, we now have three or four extension issues collected and we should release, and it's already, I don't know, 1 month passed, which is very common. Then we release a so-called collective security bulletin where we just state, okay, these have been recently fixed, recently from 1 to, I don't know, sometimes 4 months in extensions. And this is also the situation where we are going to mark the old extensions to be insecure. So if you, that's why I mentioned the caretaker, you will notice that the extension is insecure in the repository only when we release the collective security bulletin. And we do this a little bit by severity of the issue, but mainly by the by how popular the extension is. So if we have an extension that is roughly had roughly 3 downloads, then we schedule it for a collective security bulletin. If it has 1 million downloads, we make a single, independent security bulletin only for this extension. And this process basically looks like the core process. So everything is in private until we release the advisory. And in the same moment we release the advisory, we release the fixed version of the extension. Any further questions? Yeah.
This is something that we noticed. I believe it was the last security release, just the FAL that you mentioned. I think we noticed that the security release was based on the latest development branches and not the latest stable releases. So this led to the fact that the security releases did not only include the security patches, but also other functional changes that, if I remember correctly, also included some regressions. Is this actually considered best practice or?
No. actually, this is not considered best practice, and we try to change it, but this is also a problem with lack of manpower a little bit, because if we wanted to only include the security fixes, schedule a date where we can say, okay, at this point in time, the security team and some of the core team members have time to release it, but we have to schedule a regular release beforehand that we can say, okay, we release all bug fixes with a version and then we wait 1 week because there might be some regressions or functional changes or whatever in this release, so we have to wait a little more time, a time span. And then basically from that release to the security release, we would have to do a merge freeze, which is also kind of complicated to communicate and to handle if work needs to be done. So we did this, I think, 3 or 4 times, that we just released the regular release and then had a merge freeze for 1 week, at least for the release branches, not for the development branch. But yeah, it takes more time. It's more a little bit more complicated to handle, and we would like to improve it. But we need to find out how we can do it without consuming so much resources for that. So, if you have any ideas, for example, one idea would be to just base it whatever bug fix is included in. Meanwhile, in a release branch, we just base it on the previous tag and release a security release, and then after that, merge back the security release in the normal branch. So this would be one possibility, but we must figure out a workflow for that. Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
Any further questions? Right, no? So, thank you. If you'd like to contact me, you can find me on Twitter. You can read my blog if you like. There will be some more posts coming related to Type 3. And you can also write me an email to me personally if you have some questions, or of course you can use security@type3.org as an email address if you want to help us or have ideas or have comments or have any security issue. Thank you very much.